Hi, Hans. So we've partnered with our friends at Yakult to bring you a very special episode of the pod talking all things gut health. Yakult are the gut experts and have been on a mission to inspire well-being for over 85 years. And now they're welcoming a new member of the family to help you feel peachy. The new Yakult Plus Peach, bursting with delicious peach flavor and packed with billions of friendly bacteria. Plus, it's rich in vitamin C, which supports immunity and helps lower fatigue. Make Yakult Plus Peach part of your daily ritual for your hit of happy. It's now available at Ocado and other independent stores across the UK. Yakult, little bottle, big difference.
Gut health isn't just like this hippie kind of thing. It's genuine.
How much is our lifestyle, travel, exercise, sleep, stress connected to gut health?
Oh my gosh, it's huge. Less than 2% of nutrition information on TikTok is accurate. They are preying on vulnerable people. They're not evidence-based. They're the biggest con out there. It's like golden, like liquid.
Do baked beans or beans in general make you gassy?
I knew that was coming.
Guys, welcome to a special episode of So Wrong It's Right, partnering with Yakult. You guys know I am a big health geek, but more importantly, gut health geek. So we're going to do a very special episode today. And I'd love to introduce you to my amazing guest. She is a Sunday Times best-selling author of The Science of Nutrition, host of the Food for Thought podcast, and a registered nutritionist. Everyone, Rhiannon Lambert. Now, we are celebrating Yakult's Plus Peach. It's bursting with delicious peach flavour, packed with billions of gut-friendly bacteria and also rich in vitamin C, so it supports immunity and helps lower fatigue. I think we could all say we'll benefit from that. Let's talk a little bit about you first, and how did you get into nutrition? Was it always an interest of yours? How did your journey into this career start?
I've got a bit of an odd journey. It wasn't
normal. We love that.
I know, but it wasn't normal. I used to be a soprano. So yeah, I'm a singer originally.
As in, like, when they sing it really high.
Yeah, yeah.
What?
Yeah. So it was, I won a competition with Classic FM when I was 17. No one musical in my family whatsoever.
How did you know you could sing like that?
I just copied things I'd heard.
Yeah.
And what I leaned towards was stuff like Phantom of the Opera. And this kind of, I was a bit of an odd child.
I was going to say, it sounds like you had niche interests.
Very
for
niche.
A 17-year-old.
Very niche interests, yeah. And that kind of changed my life. So winning that competition online, I got moved up to London, got to study at the Royal Academy of Music, obviously while paying my own rent and, you know, looking for jobs. Used to hand out CVs back then. There was no social media. So. It was very different. And it got to a point of about, I'd say like 3 or 4 years of being signed by labels, dropped by labels, economies crashing in 2008, things going up, down, up, down, that I just thought, I want to go and study something. And it wasn't popular back then. So I'm talking quite a long way ago. And there were only like 5 courses in the country that did nutrition. So I enrolled in a degree, nutrition health. I was kind of classified as a mature student being 21, obviously.
Wow.
I know, right? It kind of...
What would that make us now?
I know. I look back on myself and I think I was such a baby. But compared to the 18-year-olds just going, I wasn't. I'd already been working in the industry, you know, for so long. And I got a first class degree and went on to do my master's. And now I have nutrition and my clinic and the books. So that's how I got into it.
That's incredible. What an amazing journey. And like you say, I think, let's say the last 5 years, nutrition, health, and predominantly gut health, which is what we want to talk about today, has become way more popular, way more talked about. I feel like we're catching up with our US sisters. I feel like the UK, we're always a little bit slower to jump on the bandwagon of things. And I think that almost what we used to kind of take the mickey out of, that kind of LA lifestyle and thinking about the connections between your body and what you put in it, we're all now starting to become aware of it.
Yeah, we need it so much more. And it's also countries like Australia.
Yes.
Pulling in things from the Mediterranean diet more. You know, we know the research on diets from Asia, from the Mediterranean, Norway, Scandinavian countries. So gut health isn't just like this hippie kind of thing. It's genuine. I mean, I'm teaching my four-year-old there are belly bugs in his belly. But I never grew up thinking about these bugs that live inside me and how what I eat could actually do me good rather than harm. So yeah, it's a big topic.
How much is our lifestyle, travel, exercise, sleep, stress connected to gut health?
Oh my gosh, it's huge. Right, exercise the more you exercise, the more diverse your gut microbiome. So let's talk about gut health essentially mm-hmm. means when your gut is free from any problems like constipation, diarrhea, an illness, and you want to have a healthy gut. And we've got trillions of bacteria in our gut.
And it's so interesting when, like you say, we have a kind of epidemic of people suffering with mental health, but then we also are seeing, you know, more people eating bad diets and eating on the go and eating out of convenience. And like I said, that there is obviously a really loud link between the two.
It's just so huge. And I think we have a bit of a problem at the moment with the sense that, you know, 70% of children's diets are made up of ultra processed foods, 60% of adults. So what we're doing actually is we're deficient in fiber and we're deficient in nutrients in this country that are mm-hmm. going to feed our gut box.
Yes.
And of course, our gut's also linked to our immune system. So 70% of our gut bugs kind of reside in that area. And our gut bugs train our immune system. So by not eating well, we're also not supporting the immune system, which keeps us well.
What are some simple things that people could do who are listening and watching today to start improving their gut health? What are some foods that you would say off the top of your head, go down your local shops and start including these in your diet?
Okay, I call them the super six, like a group of foods that I think everybody should get more of. And they're obvious things like fruit.
Fruit.
Veg.
So people demonizing fruit because the sugar content.
Don't, Olivia. I can't.
You don't subscribe to this nonsense.
I mean, don't drink too much fruit juice.
But fruit in its natural form with the fiber is always a good thing.
It's always a good thing. And anyone online saying fruit is not fruit, all these conspiracy theories are wild.
Wild.
Fruit is really good for you. Please eat more. Most of the UK do not even get their fiber a day. That's a problem.
Yeah.
So let's focus on fruit, on veg, nuts and seeds.
Okay.
Tough one for people. They're more expensive now, but if you get like a big bag in bulk, that's the cheapest way to do it, and they last forever if they're sealed airtight. Herbs and spices.
Okay, when so they actually pay, even dried ones?
Yeah, even dried ones. Even chocolate, by the way, dark chocolate.
Like in its most almost purest form.
Okay. Can help support our gut bugs. And then the final two food groups are whole grains, like carbs. Don't demonize carbs.
No.
We need that fiber. It's so beneficial if you eat the right type. With carbs, I always say the quality and the quantity, like the two cues, how much carbohydrate and what type. So whole grain pasta, brown stuff, basically, that you want to eat more of. And then beans and pulses, legumes.
Beans and pulses.
They're cheap. People don't
eat
them.
When you say with carbs, because I remember I was talking to a nutritionist once and I'd gone to that stage where I was like demonizing bread. And she was like, let me make it really simple for you. There are some breads I'd stay away from. If you go on the back of the bread and it's got 85 ingredients and it stays fresh for 3 weeks, it's not great. When you go to a bakery and you get that bread that within 2 days is going to go stale, it's a real bread. It's made in the way that bread was meant to be made. Get it down, you.
I mean, it's because it doesn't have the emulsifiers and the preservatives in it to make it last longer. So if we look at ultra-processed foods very quickly, because I think this is so topical right
now.
We don't need to fear them. They had a place to help people because some people do need that bread to last a bit longer.
Absolutely.
But for most of us, if you're looking at your gut health, try and get the ones without the additives on the back and just put it in your freezer. Slice it, put it in your freezer.
I was just about to say, because I buy like a fancy rye bread now and I put it sliced, I put it in the freezer and I put it straight from the freezer to the toaster and it's changed my life. I've never thrown away a piece of bread since. Yeah. And it's the most obvious thing, but I thought I would have to defrost the whole loaf. Who's going to do that? Literally, from freezer to toaster and it's perfect. Then you never waste it.
It's got more resistant starch. So when you cool down bread and then you cook it again, you create a really beneficial fiber strain because the gut bugs inside us eat the food we can't really digest.
Yes.
So all the light veg and the list I just mentioned, the super six, if you just remember super six. They're the foods you want every day.
Yes.
And your gut loves to eat that stuff, which is why you'll then grow a better gut garden. And that type of bread is going to help support that gut garden.
I want to do a little segment now. I'm going to call it Yakult Mythbusters. Okay. So I think a really good way for the wrong cunts, the listeners and the viewers of the podcast, just to get as much sort of actionable information from this episode as possible, I'm going to fire at you some gut-related questions and then we can just fire through them. Yeah. And that way, I think it's easy for people to take the information.
Okay, quick answers.
Which would you say negatively affects gut health the most? Exercise, lack of sleep, diet or drinking water?
Depends on the diet. Obviously, a poor diet's not great. But I would say out of all of those, if you're eating a good diet, sleep. I mean, sleep is a killer. It's definitely sleep.
True or false? traveling has no impact on your gut health as long as you're consistent with your diet.
Fiction. Travel has a huge impact.
It's interesting, isn't it? Because we were talking about the biological rhythms of our bodies and all that stuff. And like you say, I've traveled before and I'm almost more vigilant with my, washing my hands.
Water
and you're not having ice in some countries, all those things. And then your gut's so unhappy and you think, why? But like you say, if I'm in LA and my body's normally asleep and my stomach's bloated or I'm not regular. And also, isn't that the most, I don't know about your friendship group, maybe you're normal, but my friendship group, the most talked about on the first day is like, who's been to the toilet, who hasn't?
Yeah, I wouldn't say I'm normal, but no. I go with
it. It's like the most talked about thing. What's everyone's bowels doing? Like, it's disgusting. Who's blocked up? Who's going too often? Like, that's what the whole trip talking about.
I know, but I think people should know, right, that up to three times a day is normal, up to three times a week is normal. But if you are not going for a week, please go see your GP. I cannot express enough how important
if you're not going number two for more than a few days at a time.
More than maybe 5 to 7 days around that benchmark.
Jesus. I mean, yeah, that's
it's quite common.
That's quite terrifying, isn't it?
Yeah. And it's poor diet contributes. Mm-hmm. We've got to remember, you touched on bloating. And I just want to let your listeners know that lifestyle factors make such a difference. Like tight clothing, like we're sat here with our high-waisted trousers.
I know.
You know, when you sit down like this and they're hunched up, that also can impact your gut health just as much in terms of bloating. So trapped gas, trapped air.
So there's several things that can make you bloat aside from what you're eating.
Yeah, we've got to think about being more mindful, you know, deep breathing, breath work, you know, CBT therapy is known to be beneficial for bloating. It's actually a lot.
I get quite bloated and I do think I haven't taken a real deep breath since like 2015. Like, so I do sometimes, so I'm like, oh my God, why is my heart racing?
I know, and your shoulders are going.
Brad's like, you walk around like this. You look like, you know, from the Addams Family. What's his name?
Gomez. I can't remember. Yeah, the other one.
The butler. Okay, should we do some listener questions?
Yeah.
They're good ones, actually. Okay. First listener question. Are you ready?
All right.
What is the best way to eat? Carbs or no carbs? Meat or no meat? Lots of conflicting advice online.
I hear you. I mean, it's confusing, right? Yes. What do you eat? The first thing is don't listen to the voices online for your nutrition information, because less than 2% of nutrition information on TikTok is accurate. That was a study recently. So just so you know, TikTok's not the place to go.
Wow.
Everyone's different. Try and look at a balanced plate. It's such simple advice, but try and think, have I got all the food groups in my meal every day? Have I got some carbs for that fiber for your gut bugs? Have I got protein? Have I got some vegetables or fruit and a little bit of healthy fat from olive oil or something?
Yes.
Olive oil is like golden, like liquid. It's beautiful.
Good
fats. It's the best stuff in the world. Yeah. So don't be scared to cook with fats. Don't be scared of carbohydrates. Quantity and quality of carbs. Some people do overdo it. They eat too much of the refined carbohydrates, the ultra processed varieties.
Yeah.
Be wise about your choices.
Okay, second question from one of the wrong huns. Does turmeric actually work for inflammation?
Oh, it's a hard one, isn't it? Do you know why I love this one? Because there is some really good studies, but I must state they're in laboratories and they use capsules of turmeric. But if you've got a pill that has a really high dose of turmeric inside,
like in its most like concentrated,
really potent, and it's given in a certain quantity every day, it's in a controlled trial environment, people have seen results with the fact that it supports your immune system, might lower inflammation. However, the dried turmeric that you see in your larder at home or on the shop shelves that you're adding to food, you would not get enough of the potency from that dried form being sat there for so long to have an impact, let alone the quantity. And you're actually better off buying the root. A lot of people don't buy fresh turmeric.
They just buy it dried in a jar.
It looks like ginger if you've ever wondered what it looks like. And it's got such a good orange colour. And you can actually freeze that too if you chop it up or grate it and freeze it. And then you can pop it in your meals for a slight health benefit. I can't make claims, but...
But you said, all the kind of herbs and spices are good anyway. So kind of including them is never going to hurt.
Absolutely.
But if you supplemented it, there's evidence to suggest that it could
potentially,
help.
Potentially.
You're not going to do any harm, basically.
No,
it's natural.
But I wouldn't say go out and buy a load of pills with it. I would try and get it in the food form.
Great. Okay, next one. Oh, this is a very broad question.
Okay.
How can I ease IBS symptoms?
Irritable bowel syndrome. So many people are impacted. Like, we said earlier, there's lifestyle things, sleep, stress. It's so hard in today's society, the amount of ultra processed foods you eat, the tight clothing, the things we're doing. But ultimately, if this is causing you severe pain and discomfort, go to your GP. Mm-hmm. Then if your GP doesn't specialize in this area, you're not getting the support you need, push, 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 and then go and see a registered dietitian or nutritionist.
So you if you are suffering from actual IBS and it's unmanageable, it's impacting your day-to-day life, you need professional advice and help.
There's different stages. Like, you can only manage so much at home, and then if it's still, you're not seeing any improvements, some people need so much more help and a holding hand. Don't just Google a FODMAP diet and go and jump on a diet for IBS. Get the advice first and do it with your handheld, because it's a lot.
Because like they might want to do stool samples and different tests to see what they're actually dealing with.
Do you know what? When it comes to gut tests, there's not really any accurate ones.
Oh, really? That's so interesting.
And it's really hard. The reason why this is such a grey area, and it's for my clinicians in my clinic, it's really difficult, the ones that are working in the NHS at the moment. It's an elimination diet. It's the only real way to figure out, because everyone's unique. I don't know how many gut bugs you've got of certain strains in your tummy. You know, I don't know in mine. And because we're unique, we've got the element where we all react to foods differently. So until you take them out and then put them in, you don't truly know.
Are any of the online tests worth doing when it comes to gut health?
Do you know, if I sold an online test, I would be like a millionaire, I swear. The amount of people we see in my clinic every single day that come in saying they're intolerant to like a huge list of everything you could imagine, from peas to a pear to yeast.
Also, when we say online tests, just for anyone listening who doesn't know what we mean, we're referring to these kits that you can buy for hundreds of pounds. You prick your finger and you put a little bit of blood, or you spit into something.
Yes,
like this is what we're talking about, right?
And hair tests. Like, they all exist. Like, take a piece of your hair and then I'll tell you what you can eat or can't eat. They are preying on vulnerable people. Like, we're all desperate for answers. Wouldn't we all? I'd love to know every single gut bacteria strain I had, or what my food's more adapted to, but they're just taking your money because we do not have concrete research there. Okay. They're not evidence-based. They're the biggest con out there, and a huge red flag for those types of tests. You can only test efficiently for lactose intolerance.
So it's out of all that massive list that they're sending you.
Exactly.
It's a bit of...
We can't really do it. And then even celiac, so severe allergy, you used to have to do a biopsy. You don't have to just do that anymore. But there's a whole grey area here of test kits. My advice is stay clear and spend the money that you would have spent on that, which is a lot cheaper than that, on an actual registered nutritionist or dietitian to go through your diet.
Great advice. There's some questions that were so frequently asked that I put them into a kind of a common questions category. What would be a great breakfast to support your gut?
You can have porridge. Porridge is one of my favourites.
It's a good one,
because you can like pimp it up. I know there's more scaremongering again on oats online. It's not true. You can mix everything up how you want. Just make sure that you pair your breakfast with protein and fat, so you slow the release of sugars.
Well, I was going to say, I think a lot of the demonising around porridges, if you eat a bowl of porridge and you throw honey on top, then you are probably going to have a glucose crash half an hour later.
But and like you say, water. It's just
throw
like
a handful of almonds on there, some nut butter. Look at me.
Look, is this your everyday breakfast?
this would be a typical thing I would eat. Yeah, and actually, since I did do that, because I've always been a big porridge fan, because I love the, like, it's just easy. It's warm, especially
it's
in the winter.
Right?
Yeah. Since I have started to add things into it, your big tablespoons of chia seeds. I don't feel starving like half an hour later. Like it does keep me going longer. Yeah. So it didn't put me off porridge. It's just I've changed the way I dress it up.
Yeah, you have to pimp it up and you have to put things on it. And for some people, porridge, if they've got an underlying condition or they do react and they're more sensitive to blood sugars, have eggs for breakfast, have some avocado, have some whole grain bread, like we mentioned, get it out the freezer. And then there's no protein actually with just bread and avocados. Mm. Add your seeds, add your nuts, you know, that's going to bring the protein. Hummus, like pancakes, you can make delicious pancakes with banana, oats and yogurt or whatever. So
I've really got into a habit, and this is like so many people would not get on board with this, but I love eating a leftovers for breakfast. I've got into such
dinner
into such a, this is like so many people be like, okay, no, I'm good. And Brad's like, my husband's like, you're a weirdo. But once you, because I've been trying to move towards a more savoury breakfast. It's like the other day, I literally had like a piece of cold salmon, like cooked salmon with a bit of Greek salad from the night before. Brad was like, Fab. It's niche. I'm not saying you have to do it, but once you kind of change your, you get out of your head that like the, you're the continental croissant for breakfast, which actually doesn't really do anything for us. Once you kind of get it out of your brain and you get into the habit of eating more savory foods to start your day, it doesn't feel as weird. It's actually, I crave more protein and savory foods now.
It's a cultural thing.
What's your food vice or bad habit? So, for example, I love a little slice of salami. What's something that you know is not good, but you love it?
I know I'm a nutritionist, but it doesn't mean I eat perfectly. Mm-hmm. I love sugar.
Okay, sweet tooth girl.
Oh my goodness. I think there's definitely a psychological component to it, but I'm obviously careful about what I eat. But when I was pregnant, I could live off milk chocolate buttons. I mean, really? Like daily. It was bad. So just to make anyone feel better, we all have our things. But now if I'm looking at it, I know, for instance, to pick chocolate that doesn't have as much preservatives in it. And I'm really careful about which type. But I'm a big believer, and I spoke about this on my TED talk, that if you allow yourself enjoyed items, you're less likely to binge, less likely to overeat, and you do not have these crazy cravings. It's people that are very all or nothing, and so many of my clients are all or nothing. It's just the way we're inbuilt in society to think, oh, I'll go cold turkey, I'll give something up. It's not helpful because it doesn't instill a healthy relationship with food.
100%. I feel like, because the way I've always eaten, and I don't know who kind of instilled this in me, but I never say no to myself for anything I don't want. But if I fancy a biscuit, I'll have a biscuit. But like you say, if I didn't let myself have a biscuit for a week, then I'd probably be eating a whole packet of biscuits.
Exactly.
So if you let yourself have that little thing that you want, then it doesn't become this thing that when you get hold of it, you're just going to black out and wake up in a around crisp packets and sweets.
Yeah.
And it actually doesn't, it kind of takes away that brain psychological thing where it's like a forbidden fruit.
It's like, it's really intense. So just to say to anyone that's experiencing disordered eating, listening, or more severe, obviously psychological illness, like an eating disorder, these things need to be worked on with a health professional. But ultimately, you can break the binge cycle. It's so possible.
Do baked beans or beans in general make you gassy?
I knew that was coming. I was like, how could we not do a gut health episode? No, actually, it's kind of a fact because, well, it depends on how used to having baked beans you are.
Yeah.
Or beans in general, because your gut bugs love beans and pulses. So when they eat a food, they then give off gas as a byproduct. So if you're not used to eating a high amount of fiber and you suddenly you do, your gut bugs are going to go crazy. Like,
so are beans high fiber? So even a baked bean in a tomato sauce is high in fiber.
Example of an ultra processed food that's good and you should have, because it's one of the super six. It's beans and pulses. I want everyone to get more. And also replace some of your animal produce every week. Like if you have meat every day, try and swap it for half-half, like fill your bolognese with lentils and beans and then switch to maybe having one day a week where you have a veggie meal and try and build on that.
And also if you like baked beans, there are so many options on the shelves now where they haven't got all the sugar and stuff. There's actually ones where it's real tomato juice and it's a bit, do you know what I mean? If you look, and again, like we
and
say,
mixed
it's not
beans, not just one type, because normally it's haricot beans, but you know, you can get like five bean salads in cans.
My mum was used to make these like sort of curry, chili con carnes and stuff when we were younger. My mum's always been big into health and she'd throw all these different types of beans into it to, you know, get them into our diet. And we'd see all these different beans and be like, why does this woman hate us? These disgusting, me and my sister look at each other and be like, why? Why is there, what are these?
But
and
you're thankful
like,
now.
Thankful now. Now I'm like, thank you for educating us and feeding us a really healthy diet. But when you're a kid, you're like, my friend gets, you know, but SpaghettiOs.
The sweet drawer and all, the hoops.
And I won't tell you what my mum's response to that would be. Rhiannon, this has been amazing. I could just talk to you all day. Yeah. Honestly, it's been absolutely fascinating. And I want to thank Yakult for bringing us this very special episode where we've managed to debunk lots of myths. I hope the wrongins have had lots of actionable information to take from this. It's actually been a bit of an education and not too boring while we ramble on, because I know I'm a massive gut health geek. But thank you very much.
Thanks for having me.
Hey Huns, so we've partnered with our friends at Yakult to bring you a very special episode of the pod talking all things gut health. Yakult are the gut experts and have been on a mission to inspire well-being for over 85 years. And now they're welcoming a new member of the family to help you feel peachy. The new Yakult Plus Peach, bursting with delicious peach flavor and packed with billions of friendly bacteria. Plus, it's rich in vitamin C, which supports immunity and helps lower fatigue. Make Yakult Plus Peach part of your daily ritual for your hit of happy. It's now available at Ocado and other independent stores across the UK. Yakult, little bottle, big difference.